combinations. So remember when we have, let me do it with numbers first. When we have, just a second, we got some more. All right, when we have something like the combinations of six things taken four at a time, that formula, remember, is 6 factorial, that number right there, over, we subtract those and get 2 factorial, and then we have that number, 4 factorial. So it's this one on top, subtract them, and this one on the bottom. So when I look at this that has letters in it, remember, this is another notation for combinations. So this means the combinations of n things taken 2 at a time. That's just another notation. That is going to be, according to my formula, that is going to be n factorial over n minus 2 factorial, 2 factorial. So it's the first number, the top number, factorial, subtract these, and that one on the bottom. So what does this look like? N plus 1 over 2, N plus 1, not over 2. What is that going to look like? Anybody want to hazard a guess?
You're going to put N plus 1 factorial on the top.
Yep. And then we subtract them. So what do you get when you subtract these two? What is n plus 1 minus 2?
N minus 1.
Yep. And then 2. So we simply subtract those, and then that one also goes on the bottom. So now what I'm supposed to be doing, according to the problem, is adding these two together, and supposedly, all I'm going to have left with is n squared. All right, so let's see what that looks like when I add them together, start adding them together. Okay, so this guy right here. What does n factorial mean? What does n factorial mean? Well, what does 6 factorial mean?
6 times 5 times 4 times.
Okay, so whatever the factorial number is, you start with that number, and then you keep multiplying by one less. So we'd start with n, and then we'd have n minus 1, and then we'd have n minus 2, and n minus 3, and so on and so on and so on until we get down to 1. So what would n minus 2 factorial be?
N minus 2, N minus 1.
No. You keep subtracting 1. So it would be N minus 2, but then it would be N minus 3, N minus 4, and so on. Right? And then we also have a 2 factorial, which is just 2 times 1. Now, that's a real mess, but what happens in that? What's going to happen up there?
Everything except for n minus 1
cancel out. Yep, so this is going to be gone, all of that's gone, and all of this is gone. So that first thing just ends up being n times n minus 1 over the 2 from the 2 factorial down there. Because everything from the n minus 2 on, like Nicholas said, everything from the n minus 2 on is just going to cancel. So that's all that's left from the first one. All right, now let's do the same thing with the second one. What will n plus 1 factorial be?
N minus 1.
What do we start with?
N plus 1.
We start with n plus 1, and then we reduce by 1, so that would be n, and then we reduce by 1 again and again and so on and so on and so on. So what would n minus 1 factorial look like? Where does it start with?
N minus 1.
And then it decreases by 1. So it would be n minus 2, n minus 3, dot, dot, dot. And then we still have, from the original problem, we still have the 2 times 1 down there. So do you see that just exactly what happened in the first part there is also going to happen in this part? Everything from the n minus 1 on is going to be gone. And I have n plus 1 times n over 2. Remember, the original problem asked me to add these two together. So I'm kind of simplifying them a little bit before I add them. But now I'm adding them together. So they already have a common denominator, which is great. So that's n squared minus n plus n squared plus n. When I just do my distributive property, right? It is one big fraction because it has a common denominator. What happens? Don't these cancel? So what am I left with? N squared plus n squared, which is 2n squared. And lo and behold, believe it or not, it did all reduce to just plain old n squared. Okay. You might want to spend, if you're a little bit confused, you might want to spend a little more time looking at that. Just remember that whatever factorial you have, I don't care if it's a letter or a number, whatever your factorial is, you start with that thing and then reduce by ones. And every time you put factorials over factorials, stuff is going to cancel. Okay, so now we got to talk a little bit about a couple definitions, and then we're going to do some probability problems. Okay. Can anybody tell me what probability is by definition? Like, what is the mathematical definition for probability?
The chances that something is likely going to happen.
Okay. So how is it calculated? Like when you tell me that there's a 20% chance that something will happen, what does that mean? What does that 20 represent, that
20%? 20 out of 100 times.
Exactly, exactly. So what probability is, is the number of successful outcomes. And by successful outcomes, we mean what you want. So the number of ways you can get what you want over the total outcomes. So if we tell you the probability is 20% of you getting a sunburn today, that means that if you went outside on 100 days, 20 of those you would get sunburned. Now that is different to the mathematician than odds. Some people use those words interchangeably, and that's okay, but in math class, they mean different things. Odds are the number of successful outcomes over the number of failing outcomes. So in other words, probability is what you want out of the total, and odds are what you want over what you don't want. So if I said to you, I'm going to flip a coin, what is the probability that I would get heads? If I flipped a coin, what is the probability I would get heads? What would you say? What is your answer?
50%.
50% or 1/2. And probabilities can be answered as fractions, decimals, or percents. So you can always answer probability. There's nothing wrong with 50%. Odds are generally written as a ratio, so I'm going to go ahead and use 1/2, but that's the same as 50% for the probability. Now, the odds of getting a head, if I flip a coin, the odds are 1-to-1. It's called even odds, which means you have exactly the same choice of, or chance of winning the game as you have as, of losing the game. One time you'll win, one time you'll lose. One time you'll win out of two total. These two things say exactly the same thing. They're just expressed differently. So if I told you that the probability of your having to take the exam, the probability of your taking the exam is 3/7, then what would be the odds of your taking the exam? Can you convert it? What would the odds be?
3-to-4.
3-to-4. This means 3 wins out of a total of 7. This means 3 wins and 4 losses. They say exactly the same thing. They're just expressed differently. Okay? All right. Now, let's do some probability questions then. These first few are really, really easy. They can get a little more complicated, so try to be patient and just enjoy the easiness. I would really appreciate your sharing your answers with me and not just sitting there. I've already talked to myself for a lot today. I'd rather hear you. Here we go. Maggie has a bag of M&Ms and so does Elizabeth. So the first bag is Maggie. Maggie is going to be known as the first bag, and Elizabeth is going to be the second bag. Each girl has counted the M&Ms. We set up the chart. Okay. So what this chart means is that in Maggie's bag, for example, 30% of the M&Ms are green. 20% are yellow, and so on. All right, so here we go. Question A. I'm going to pick a candy from Elizabeth. What is the probability it will be green? Answer is?
20%.
0.2. That's right. You can say 20%. I'm going to go ahead and just use the decimals, but you absolutely can say 20%. There's nothing wrong with that. Now, what is the probability if I choose one from Maggie's bag? It will not be yellow. Not be yellow from Maggie. What would that one be?
0.8.
Yep, it's anything but yellow. It's coming out of Maggie's bag. There's a 20% chance it'll be yellow. That means there's an 80% chance it will not be yellow. Now I'm taking one from each bag. And I want to know the probability that they'll both be red. Well, what's the probability I'll get a red one from Maggie?
0.2.
And, which always means multiply, and I want a red one from Elizabeth.
0.6.
A red one from Elizabeth.
0.3.
And then be real careful, guys. You ought to be able to multiply this, but you might want to use your calculator. It's actually 0.06. You got to make sure you're keeping track of those decimal places when you are multiplying these decimals. All right, D. A candy is chosen from each bag. What's the probability that neither will be brown? Neither will be brown.
0.2 times 0.1.
Be careful. It says That's going to be a little bit tricky because there you can't get any browns. So neither brown is different than one could be brown and the other one can't. So your idea of subtraction isn't going to work this time.
I just thought like you can multiply like the percentage and then like take 100 and subtract by that.
Yes. No, it doesn't work in this case because 1 minus neither brown, or 1 minus both brown, which is what you're trying to do. You're saying, let's do both brown. 1 minus both brown is not neither brown. Because what does this include? 1 minus both brown would give us everything except both brown. And doesn't that include 1 brown? This includes 1 brown, and I can't have 1 brown. So you can only do the 1 minus when you are considering everything except that. And I'm not. I'm not considering 1 brown. So I can't do it that way. It's much easier, Jacob, much less convoluted to simply look at it and say, okay, what's the probability I won't get a brown from Maggie? 0.8. And the probability I won't get a brown from Elizabeth is 0.9. So the probability that I won't get either brown is 0.72 or 72%. All right, remember Maggie is first and Elizabeth is second. So for the next problem, I want to know what's the probability that I will get a green one from Maggie and a blue one from Elizabeth. So the answer to E is 0.06. I am drawing a green one from the first bag and a blue one from the second bag. Now that is different than question F. What is different with question F?
There's not really like a specific, well, no, it's this blue and green, it's like included in both bags.
So I can get blue and green, or I can get green and blue. It doesn't matter which M&M comes from whose bag. I just want to end up with a blue one and a green one. So blue and then green. This is blue from Maggie, green from Elizabeth, or green from Maggie and blue from Elizabeth. It could be either way. It doesn't say that I have to get blue first and then green. It says I just want to end up with one of each. So I could get one of each in Maggie blue, Elizabeth green, or Maggie green, Elizabeth blue. So this one's 0.02, this one's 0.06. What am I going to do with these two answers now? What does that or tell me to do? Add. When you have this or this, your total probability or your total options or your total of anything is found by adding. When I am choosing blue and green, I multiply. When it can be BG or GB, I add. What's the probability neither will be red? Neither red would be 0.8 times 0.7, so 0.56. If the probability of a red is 0.2, then not a red is 0.8, and similarly with the other bag, multiply them together. All right, I'm going to erase those and move on to the next problems, which are a little different. Anybody have a question about any of that? All right, now we're going to do some card problems. A couple of these might be a little tricky, but most of them are pretty straightforward. So the very first question just simply says, how many five-card hands are possible from a standard deck? So this is not a probability. It's not asking you what the probability is. It's just saying how many are possible. What do you think? Who's got an idea?
There's like 52 cards in total from the standard deck.
Yep.
So
yep. And how many?
Just take five and divide that by 52.
No, but you've got all the right numbers going on there. You said there's 52 cards in the deck, and I'm going to choose five of them. Order doesn't matter. I am simply picking five cards out of 52. That's it.
Does it turn hands?
No, that's a huge number. I don't know what that is. These are different hands. We're not drawing them all at the same time. Yeah. We're not taking them all at the same time. We're just saying how many different hands would be possible. I'm not sure what just happened. It's a lot. It's 2,598,960. So if you just sat down and drew five cards out of a deck, there would be this many possible outcomes for you to come up with. That's a lot. Okay, now I want you to look at every other problem in this whole section, and it goes clear to M. So look at B through M. Do you see how they all say, what's the probability? The denominator of every single problem in this section is going to be 52C5. Because the denominator of a probability question is the total possible. And if you are picking a five-card hand, then the total possible is 52C5. No matter what the numerator is, no matter what kind of hand you're trying to get, your denominator is always the total, and that would be 52C5 if you are picking a five-card hand from a standard deck. All right, gang? So every single one of these problems in this whole section is going to have that denominator. All right, so let's work on the numerators now. What it B, B says, what is the probability of being dealt a hand with all diamonds? Now remember, your numerator is what you want. So you're going to put how many all diamond hands are possible up here. How many diamonds are there?
13.
And we are going to pick all five of them. So that is your numerator. That is the numerator. There are 13 diamonds and you want five. Remember, the numerator is what you want. Please don't think anything cancels here. Somebody the other day just said 1/4. No. We'll go ahead and type this one in. But we're not going to take the time to type all of them in. So 13C5 divided by, now I already worked that out, so I can put that in, or I can just do 52C5 in my denominator. And it's a pretty small number. It's 4.952 times 10 to the negative 4th. Now, you can leave that in scientific notation if you wish. However, if you're going to change it to a percent, you'll want to rewrite it as a decimal and change that to a percent. All right. Okay. All right, let's do the next one. What is the probability of being dealt a hand with all face cards? So now my numerator has to be all face cards. Any thought on what that might be?
Would it be 16 C5 over 52 C5?
That is a good guess. It's actually only 12. It's 12 C5 because the face cards are the cards that actually have faces on them. So that would be just the Queen, King, and Jack. Those are considered face cards. And since there's four Queens, four Kings, and four Jacks, there would be 12 altogether. All right, Jacob?
Yeah, I thought of the Joker for some reason, so.
Yeah, we got 52 cards, so we're not playing with any Jokers, all right? We're just using the regular 52 cards. All right, that's gonna be an even smaller number, by the way. That one's smaller than this one. All right, so what's the probability of being dealt an all red hand? What would that look like, all red?
Is it 26?
It is, 26C5, because half the deck is red, half of the deck is red, so 26C5. This is not one half, though. This is going to be a bigger number than these, but it is not one half. Let's just type that in. I want you to, please don't ever try to cancel and reduce here. It will not work. I got 0.0253. Anybody match that? Still not a very big number, but certainly way bigger than these guys. Alrighty, three jacks and two kings. So now we're getting very specific. We want to have three jacks and two kings. Any ideas about that?
You have to make two separate things.
We're going to have two things in the top, and they're going to be multiplied because we want jacks and kings. So what would the jack one look like?
3C5.
What? That had more than one person talking, didn't quite understand. 4C3? Because how many jacks are in the deck? Period, total, four. And I want three of them. So 4C3. Now, how many kings are in the deck?
Four.
And I want two of those. So there's your numerator. Again, the numerator is what you want. So how many cards are there that I want? Well, there's four jacks, I'm gonna pick three of them. There's four kings, I'm gonna pick two of them. The only thing in the numerator is what you want. Forget about all the other cards. Only what you want is up there on the top. All right, F. Probability of being dealt a hand with no face cards.
Is it 36C5?
Okay, I don't think so. You're making the same mistake again, Jacob. How many face cards are there?
12.
Yep. So how many cards are there that aren't face cards?
40.
Yep. So 40C5 is your numerator. There are 40 cards that aren't face cards because there are 12 that are. All right, let's keep going. We got G, H, and I. Let's see. All right, what does G say? I want a five-card hand with all of the aces.
Five.
five-card hand with all of the aces. Any ideas on that?
Might be 4c4 times 48c1.
Oh, yes! 4c4 times 48c1. Beautiful. Now, let's everybody get on the page here. There are four aces in the deck, and we want all four of them. But we need a five-card hand, which means we need one more card. There's four aces, and I got them, but I need one more card. And where is that one more card coming from? Something that's not an ace. And there are 48 of those. Beautifully done. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. All right. I want to have two tens, two jacks, and one queen. Two tens, two jacks, and one queen. Here we go. Easy. What's that top going to be? We've already talked about it.
Would it be like 4c2 times 4c2 times 4c1?
That's exactly what it would be. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. There are four jacks, and I want two of them. There are four tens, and I want two of them. And there's four queens, and I want one of those to round out my five cards. Perfect. I want no aces, no queens, and no fives. So how will I do that? If I want the probability of having no aces, no queens, and no fives. Well, how many cards are, if I pull out all the aces, queens, and fives, how many cards are left?
40.
Yep, so that's going to be 40c5. There are 40 desirable cards. The desirable cards are the ones that aren't aces, queens, and fives. All right, Jay, exactly four spades.
Is it like a problem G or 4C4 times 48C1?
Well, it's along those lines, but how many spades are in the deck?
13.
There's 13 spades. There's four aces, but there's 13 spades. And I want four of those, but I need another card. This is a five-card hand. So if I have chosen exactly four spades, then what do I need for my fifth card?
Is it 48C1?
No, it won't be 48C1.
It'll be
39C1. Remember, there are 13 spades in the deck. So there are 39 cards that aren't spades. 13 hearts, diamonds, clubs. There's 39 that aren't spades. So I want four of the spades and one of the not spades. It's very similar to this problem, but this problem wasn't dealing with suits. This problem was dealing with specific cards. So there are four aces, meaning there are 48 non-aces. But there are 13 diamonds, so there's 39 not diamonds. Or spades, whatever it is I'm doing there. Now, K is similar with a little bit of a wording change. What does at least four spades mean?
You can have more than four?
Well, in this case, since it's only a five-card hand, I could have four spades, or I could have five spades, right? Because I only want five cards. So this is going to be 4 or 5 spades. Now, 4 spades I just did. 13C4 and 39C1. I just did that. What will 5 spades look like?
13C5.
Yep. So that'll be some number. This'll be some number. What am I going to do here with these two numbers since it's that or that?
Add them.
I'm going to add them. That's exactly right. I'm going to add them. I'm going to add those together. Perfect. What is the probability of being dealt at most 4 red cards? Now, keep in mind what at most means. What does at most 4 red cards mean?
Yeah, 3 red cards, 2 red cards, or 1 red card.
Or no red cards, or 4 red cards, right? You can have 4, 3, 2, 1, or 0 red cards. Now, if you look at all the possible outcomes, if I give you a 5-card hand, you could get, was it reds? Yeah. You could get no reds. You could get 1 red. You could get 2 reds. You could get 3 reds. You could get 4 reds. And you could get 5 reds. Those are the possible outcomes if you have 5 cards. Would everybody agree with that? I hand you 5 cards. You can have no reds, all reds, or any combination in between. Now, this problem is asking me to find the probability of all of this. So, 4 reds, or 3 reds, or 2, or 1, or 0. The only thing not included in this possibility is having all 5 reds. Right? So let's, instead of doing 5 separate problems, like here we had to do 2, instead of doing 5 separate problems, let's find the probability of all red. What would the probability of all 5 red look like?
0.0253.
Oh, I don't know. You've already done it. It'd be 26.
Well, I think it was the same problem as B.
So it'd be 26C5 over 52C5?
Yeah.
So let's take 100% minus that, or 1 minus that, and that would give us the probability of getting no more than 4 red cards. This is the only thing that can't be included, so we'll do 1 minus that probability. Now, M is a challenging problem. M is a challenging problem. So let's break it down a little bit. Let's do a specific case. So let's find the probability of getting 2 diamonds and 3 clubs. Because that's what the problem says. You get 2 of one and 3 of another. So let's just do that one specific case. 2 diamonds and 3 clubs. What would that look like? I know the denominator is 52C5. What's the numerator if I want to get 2 diamonds and 3 clubs? Perfect. Thank you. Now, that is not the answer to the question because it just says generically 2 of one suit and 3 of another, but this would be one of the possibilities. What would it look like if I wanted 2 diamonds and 3 spades? What would that probability look like?
Same thing.
Same thing. and, you know, two hearts and three diamonds or whatever. They all look exactly the same, all the possibilities. So what do I really need to figure out? How many possibilities there are? Now, this is where it's a little tricky. I think you'll understand it. How many, when I start finding these combinations, how many suits do I have to choose from for my first one? Like, I put diamonds here, and I put diamonds here. How many choices do I have for my two-card suit?
Four.
How many choices do I then have for my three-card suit?
Three.
So how many two-card, three-card combinations are there altogether?
12.
So the answer to the problem is 12 times that, you know, one of the probabilities. Because if I wrote out every single possibility, two clubs, three spades, two clubs, three hearts, if I wrote out every single possibility, there'd be 12 of them. This 12, by the way, is 4P2. And the reason that it's a P, and again, you can do it this way. There's nothing wrong with saying 4 times 3. But that's the same as 4P2 because there are four suits, you're choosing two of them, and the order matters. Okay? All right. That was a tough one, for sure. All right, let's see what's next. Oh, now we have some Venn diagrams. Everybody familiar with a Venn diagram? I mean, you've seen them before. So when we look at this Venn diagram, everybody understands. We've asked some people, apparently, what kind of candy they like, and they've told us this. Anybody know what that 30 means up there on the top?
The number of people in the class.
Exactly. That's the number of people in the class. That's the number of people in the box. There are 30 people in that box. What does this 11 represent right here? The 11. What is that? Who are those people?
Many people like M&Ms.
They like only M&Ms, right? These 11 like only M&Ms. What are these 6 like?
Both.
And these 9 like only Twix. So in our survey, there are 15 people who like Twix, and there are 17 people who like M&Ms. And there's 6 who like both. All right, so here we go. How many, oh, I just answered these questions. How many like M&Ms?
17.
Remember, everybody in the M&M ball likes M&Ms. If they didn't like M&Ms, they wouldn't be in that circle. So everybody in that circle likes M&Ms. How many like only M&Ms?
11.
How many like M&Ms and Twix?
6.
We're rolling. How many like M&Ms or Twix?
15. Oh, 20.
Actually, 26 like M&Ms or Twix. Those people, if I said raise your hand if you like Twix, these people would raise their hands. And raise your hand if you like M&Ms, these people would raise their hands. anybody who raised his hand likes one of those candies or both, or implies either one or both. It's called the union. The union is everybody that's in here. So these are the people in here that like one or the other or both. So that would be 26. That is different than question E. Question E says, how many like only M&Ms or only Twix? That would be 20, because that's these people or these people. They like only one kind of candy. How many like neither kind of candy?
Four.
Yep, those people are out here. There's four of them. Outside the circle, they're in the box. They're part of the 30, but they don't like Twix and they don't like M&Ms, so we can't put them in a circle. They just are out there somewhere. Now, you're going to build your own Venn diagram based on some information that's given here about liking jazz or country. Okay, and eventually we want to know how many people like only jazz. That's our question. But first we're going to build the Venn diagram. We have 18 that like jazz, and we have 14 that like country. Okay. Now, there is a critical piece of information in this problem. You have to read this thoroughly. Each of the 28 students in the class, so there's 28 kids in the class, each of them likes jazz, likes country, or both. What does that mean about out here? How many people are out here?
None.
None. Everybody is accounted for in those circles. This time, every single kid in the class has voted. I like jazz. I like country. They've all voted. All right, so let's see. When I said how many of you like jazz, 18 hands went up. When I said how many of you like country, 14 hands went up. What's wrong with that scenario?
More than 28.
Exactly. So too many hands went up, right? So what does that imply?
There's like somewhere in the middle where some people like jazz and country.
Yeah, some people voted twice, right? Which is perfectly okay. Can we figure out how many people voted twice?
Take 32 minus 28.
Exactly. Please don't make this hard, guys. This is very logical. It's easy. When I had everybody vote, 32 hands went up. But there's only 28 kids in the class. So four people voted twice. Now, if four people like both, but the whole jazz ball is 18, then how many are right here?
14.
And if the whole C ball is 14, but four of them are right here, then this part must be 10. And if you add all these up, 14, 4, and 10, you get your 28. Remember, everybody's in a ball in this problem. So now we can answer the question. How many like only jazz?
14.
14. These guys right here. All right, Brandon, I think we'll get one more. We'll only have time for one more because this is the lunch period, right? So we need to get going here. So you have time to eat. So here we go, one more. All right, these people like cars. We got 32 students. So we got Fords, Buicks, and Chevys. All right, so we've got now three circles. We have Fords, Buicks, and Chevys. 19 like Fords. Gang, you cannot put 19 in this picture because what that means is that entire circle is 19. So you cannot put him in there yet. So just record him somewhere. 19 like Fords, 19 like Buicks, and 12 like Chevys. 5 like all three. Now that you can put in there because all three has its own little section of the Venn diagram. 6 like only Fords. Well, you can put that in there too because this is the section that's only Fords. And 3 like only Buicks, and 2 like only Chevys. Now, is there any question about my placement of any of those numbers in there? Now, I have no idea what these three things are. So I'm going to call them X, Y, and Z. I know that the entire F ball is 19. So 11 plus X plus Y is 19. 11 X and Y, that whole ball, all four sections, add up to 19. Is that okay with everybody? So I'm going to go ahead and simplify. X plus Y equals 8. Now I can do the same thing for the Buicks. 8 plus X plus Z has to also be 19. Which means X plus Z is 11. And you guessed it, 7 plus Y plus Z, 7 plus Y plus Z adds up to 12. So Y plus Z is 5. Everybody okay? All right. What have I got there? What is that? That's called a system of equations. How many variables does it have?
3.
How many equations does it have?
3.
So an option I have is to set that up as a matrix and REF it. That actually takes longer than just solving it because, look here, this is what I would suggest you do. Let's just take the top two equations. This is so easy. You're going to just whiz through this. And I'm going to go ahead and multiply the second one by a negative and add. Now that's going to leave me with y minus z equal to negative 3. Y minus z, negative 3. Would you agree with that?
Yep.
And now, what can I do? That was my top two. I just eliminated the x's with my top two. Now, what can I do with my third and my new equation here? What can I do with those? Cancel the z's. So 2y equals 2 and y equals 1. So this is a 1. Y is 1. And if y is 1, what is x?
7.
Yep. And if X is 7, what is Z?
4.
Yep, and there you go. Your Venn diagram is completed. Mrs. Ford, is it always going to be that easy? Yep, it sure is. So now let's answer the question. I've got these 32 kids in my class. I'm going to reach in and grab one. What is the probability that the kid I grab likes both Chevys and Buicks? Where am I looking if I'm looking for Chevys and Buicks? It is the 5 and the 4. These kids right here are in the C ball and they're in the B ball. This football right here. Now you might say, but Mrs. Ford, these 5 also like Fords. That's fine. Question didn't address that. The question said, who likes Chevys and Buicks? That means they're in the C ball and the B ball. So the answer would be 9/32. Remember, it's a probability question. You're reaching in, grabbing a kid. You've got 9 that like Chevys and Buicks out of a total of 32. So that is the answer to A, or I, whatever the first one is there. Now, the last problem says, what's the probability that he'll like none of the cars? So you're going to reach in and grab a kid. What's the probability he won't like any of them?
0. Because there's 32 students in total that all like, oh wait, never mind. I think I put that incorrect.
It doesn't say that in this problem. Let's add all these up. How many do we have in those circles?
28.
Yeah, there's only 28 represented in here. Which means that there are 4 kids out here who don't like any of those particular cars. Would everybody agree with that? So my probability of reaching in and grabbing a kid that doesn't like any of the cars is 4/32, or 1/8. This would be the probability. Last question, and then you can escape. What are the odds of me picking a kid that doesn't like any of the cars? What would the odds be? One to 7. Because if there's one kid out of a total of 8 that don't like the cars, then there's one kid who doesn't and 7 who do. So the odds would be 1/7. The probability is 1/8. Okay? Wow. We covered a lot of ground today, and we're going to cover a lot tomorrow also. Anybody have any questions before we go to lunch? Everybody good? All right. Some of you I will actually see in person tomorrow, and the rest of you we will Zoom it again. Have a great day.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Mr. Gordon.
Have a great day. George, wake up.